Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning. Good morning, sir.
Good morning. Thank you. I hope my screen is
good. Good morning, sir.
Good morning. So let's start.
Yes, sir.
Today we'll discuss RTP as a protocol. So there are two multimedia actual protocols as part of the course. And they kind of run complementary to each other. That basically means both are needed to really run a multimedia application. First, we look at RTP, which is primarily meant for carrying the multimedia data. And next lecture, we will look at SIP, session initiation protocol. And as the name implies, that deals with setting up a session, connecting it, identifying it, notifying, ringing. So something of that kind. So let's say when you dial the phone, want to call somebody, you dial a number, you get ring back tone, ting, 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 signaling happens, call routing. Then you answer, so you're setting up a session. And then you start talking. So RTP is primarily carrying the multimedia data, and SIP would be to set up a session, terminate a session, hold, and that kind of information. So initially there was no RTP, and we still had a need to carry multimedia data. The application called Visual Audio Tool was developed at Berkeley Labs, which was the application and the protocol by itself. And that the Visual Audio Tool ran over UDP, and later on it was realized that good amount of part they are trying to deduce multimedia data can also be used by other applications. Hence, from the application part, whatever was part of transmitting multimedia data, that was put into a protocol called RTP, and that is where RTP came into existence, and currently the RFC is 3550 that defines RTP. We always need multiplexing and demultiplexing at the application when you talk with multiple people, same stack. So rather than putting its own multiplexing, UDP does that part easily, and that is the only thing that UDP does. So say let RTP use UDP and at the transport layer, but together kind of they carry multimedia data. So at times people do think RTP is a transport layer protocol, even though it sits on top of UDP there. So let's look at, before getting into details of RTP as a protocol, what are the requirements for RTP? Like when we started looking at UDP design, we said, let's look at the requirement for UDP. The requirement for UDP was we need a multiplexing and demultiplexing. Then we added a port number. Then we said we need to know the length, how much data it is. Then we defined the length field. And then we also said the receiver should detect the corruption. We added a checksum, and that's how it is. In TCP, we said we need to know how much data has been received, what is the current data segment. So we added sequence number, acknowledgement, the flags to differentiate whether data is being transmitted or the TCP connection being set up or being terminated, different phases, the receive window size, the buffer size available, and all those kind of details. And then we said, okay, this is how we design TCP header. Same way, let us look at what do we expect RTP to provide, what are our requirements, and then we will look at the protocol headers or RTP headers that accomplishes our requirements. So firstly, why RTP itself? Because once you have a standard protocol, different implementations can talk to each other as long as they adhere to the protocol. Now we have a Skype, which is used for voice over IP text messaging. We also have WhatsApp, which is again used for messaging, video conferencing, call. Can Skype with one user talk to the WhatsApp with the other user? Any thoughts? Let's say user one wants to use Skype, user two wants to use WhatsApp. Can they talk to each other? Arit? Arvind? Bhagyasri? Anyone? Pavan?
No, sir.
Why not? What is the problem? The challenge is both of them, Skype as well as WhatsApp, use a proprietary protocol which nobody knows. So you can't even develop your own client to communicate to other WhatsApp user. You have to get this software from them. But if you want to talk to a web server, HTTP protocol is well defined, and so you can use Safari, you can use Chrome, you can use Edge, you can use Firefox, with the talk to same protocol. So protocol enables different implementations, and that provides interoperability. And that's the one of the main key requirement. Second is, different applications would like to use different coding scheme. That will depend upon the bandwidth, what is available, network conditions. For example, PCM coding scheme uses 64 kbps bandwidth. GSM encoding scheme uses 13 kbps. There are other coding schemes, S261, they use again different. So protocols would support all such coding scheme. You cannot say we will deal with only one coding scheme, because your objective is to enable multimedia communication, and when different applications use different coding scheme, it should be able to support it. So that means protocol should communicate some way what is the current coding scheme being used. And they, of course, would vary depending on the bandwidth, computation cost. If I'm trying to do more compression, my computation would be heavy. Raw voice, there's only encoding, there's no computation. So and I need to support that part. Other important part is, it has to support some kind of timing relationship. I don't know, sometimes you might have noticed that when you watch a TV show or a YouTube or sometimes, or the other video on the net or even TV, what you notice is that the lips movement are not in synchronization with the audio you are hearing. There is a lag. You see, look, something is wrong. Lips are moving some way and audio something else. That basically happens because audio is coming on one stream, video is coming on the other stream, and they lag a timing relationship. So that means if I'm getting multiple streams, I should be able to identify which frames are corresponding to which time, and I should be able to play them together. Even across a single, let's say video frame, a single video frame could be large and may not come in a single RTP packet, which is small. And so if multiple packets constitute a single video frame, all of them has to be played together, and all of them should have the same timing. So somehow the receiver should know what time a packet has to be played. Even if you are getting a sequence of packets, like in a talk spurt, we should know what time is the first word to be played, what time second word to be played, what time third word segment to be played. So protocol should support timing relationship as well as synchronizing the multiple streams such as audio and video, so that you don't see a lag when the audio is being played versus the video being played. Now, the different applications deal with lossage in different way. Like we have seen, some applications might use if packet get lost using error concealment, they can repeat the previous frame, or some might do interpolation, or some protocol like to use FEC. That means there has to be some way of indicating there's a packet loss. And when packet loss occurs, can we indicate to the sender that there's a packet loss, and that packet loss basically means there's a network congestion. Network is congested. And then if application would like, it might want to even change encoding scheme. Let's say currently I'm transmitting voice at the PCM channel, which requires 64 kbps, but start seeing a packet loss, occasional packet loss, then you might want to indicate, look, there's some packet loss, so sender might change from 64 kbps to 13 kbps of GSM channel. Little low quality, but it will be able to deal with the network conditions. And that means some kind of requirement is there to inform sender, and we RTP is only dealing with multimedia transport, so we might need a separate associated protocol that indicate to the sender periodically what is the status of media being played. Is there any packet loss? Is there a delay? What is happening? Some indication so that if sender want to take an action, it can basically take an action. Furthermore, we have multiple streams coming from the same source. So rather than identifying by IP address, let's say one server is playing different applications even to the same network. So can we identify just rather than by IP address, a better ID that can indicate to multimedia streams as well and not with the IP address. So all these are what we need to have in a RTP packet header, and we'll see RTP packet header addresses all this. And of course, we need to have carry a data indicating whether it's audio data, video data, which kind of get indicated by encoding scheme anyway. So all these details are specified in RFC 3550. It basically says there is a RTP header, which will indicate what kind of encoding, indicate timing relationship, need to provide indication of packet loss, encoding scheme, and so on. So fourth number. Now RTP needs to run, because you're running in UDP, it needs to run in end system, meaning intermediate network routers don't have to really worry about what protocol being used. All the network intermediate routers, they only look at IP packet for routing. They don't even care whether it's UDP or on UDP, it is running RTP or something. So RTP is end-to-end protocol, runs only in end system. Now, when a packet is received, because you're using protocol, it's adding the headers. So at the end, you extract the data and give to the application, which application can really play. And we already talked about that we need interoperability for it to work. Now we said that RTP is primarily dealing with transmission of multimedia data. It can tell you the packet loss has occurred. And since there is no indication to the sender that there is a congestion packet loss, the sender would keep sending the same encoding rate or same rate basically. And that means we need to somewhere to indicate that packet loss are occurring. It's basically congestion, so that if sender want to change the encoding rate or do something, or want to even change the way my error management or error handling, so rather than from error this FEC, we might move to error concealment, that will save the bandwidth, all that action could be done. So there has to be a periodical report. So RTP is accompanied by another protocol called RTCP, real-time control protocol. So RTP is a protocol that is for basically dealing with multimedia data, and RTCP is control protocol, which provides a status of the data being played. And that enables sender to take action if needed there. And both protocols kind of run together if needed. So RTP always uses even port number, and RTCP uses next odd port number. For example, if RTP stream is using port number 5000, then RTCP would use port number 5001. And that's how the protocols basically use. We already said they make use of UDP as underlying protocol. And we need to identify payload identification. That basically means what kind of audio, video, or multimedia data it is. Even for the audio, there could be different encoding. We would like to know that. And so we look at how the packet structure really look at to support that. A question would come in, do we need bunch of time stamping? We know what time packet is to be played. Why do we need a packet sequence number as well? The two fields have a different purpose. Time stamping basically identifies the time to be played. It can also be used to synchronize the two packets, and they follow two different streams. Further, if it is even single video stream, a single video frame may be transmitted using multiple RTP packets. A single video frame has to be played at the same time. So all these packet frames would have to carry the same time stamping. So if, let's say, my single video frame consists of three packets, they have to carry the same time stamping, then I would not know whether something is lost or not. So we use sequence number to enable receiver to know whether the packet is lost or not. So sequence number is primarily used to identify if packets have been lost. But time stamping basically identifies or determines what time the particular multimedia packet has to be played. So we both need both, and one cannot be used for the other. This is how the packet would actually look like. You have the RTP payload, meaning the application data, basically meaning the actual video segment or actual audio segment, which will have the RTP header. And then whole thing becomes a payload to UDP, so UDP header. Whole thing becomes payload to IP, get IP header, and so on. This is how things get transmitted, which you can see in Wireshark capture as well. So consider how different fields would be used. Let's take an example. Assuming we are sending 64 kilobits voice channel, which is basically a PCM channel. Now, one thought would be to send one single packet for each 1 second segment. Now we have a voice requirement that for voice to be give a feeling of interactive, voice communication should be, delay should be less than 150 milliseconds. Now if I were to transmit the entire 1 second packet at a time, I'm already causing a delay of 1 second. So I'm losing my interactivity. So that means to make sure that packets are delivered in time and they're delivered within 150 milliseconds, I need to send a smaller voice chunk size. And I cannot send, because if I take a larger packet, it basically causes my latency delay, because that much time I need to wait before I can transmit, and that already causes my latency. So my packet size has to be small. And typically in PCM channels, we send each packet corresponding to 20 milliseconds of data. And we said 20 milliseconds of data. And since we are sending data at the rate of 64,000 bits per second or 8,000 bytes per second, so per second we are sending 8,000 bytes, that means 20 milliseconds will send 160 bytes. And this basically means when sending 20 milliseconds, so even with some minor delay, we should still be fine. And because voice interactivity has to be 150 milliseconds, so we cannot have packet size voice chunk corresponding to more than 100 milliseconds. So we need a smaller chunk size, and that's the reason typically we do send about 20 milliseconds of voice chunk in each packet. Now, so my packet would be IDO chunk. I would have RTP header, which will go as a UDP payload, and that is how packet would be transmitted. So let's look at how does my RTP header will actually look like. The RTP header needs to contain the payload type, sequencing, time step, and identifying the source. RTP does not provide any QoS kind of information or any QoS meaning quality of service, because that depends on application. But if the packet is lost, the application decides whether it has to use the playing a previous packet or interpolation or using interleaving to determine how it will deal with loss. RTP's only goal is to deliver packet and not say do retransmission and figure out what is to be done. And thus, RTP job is only giving a packet, no quality of service. So do not find any information with respect to quality of service in RTP header. It is only RTP header only consists of dealing with transmitting packet, which is type of encoding, source, sequence number, and time stamping, nothing else. Since we are talking of multiple stream, initially, let's say two people are doing video conferencing. Video conferencing requires, let's say two people A and B are doing video conferencing. That means A need to send video stream, A also need to send audio stream. And similarly, because of video conferencing, B need to send audio stream, and B also need to send video stream. So initially we have the separate video stream and separate audio stream. So now video conferencing would involve four streams. Two streams from A, two streams for B from B, and two streams from A, there has to be synchronization, that's to timestamp, and same is true for two streams from B. Now with two different streams, they may face different congestion, different issues, and synchronization dealing with them becomes much tougher. So prefer to have a single encoding scheme that can send both audio and video together. And that is where your MPEG-1 and MPEG-2 encoding scheme came in, which basically sends a single stream containing both audio and video and not two different streams. So my RTP header looks as given in the figure. We have a payload type. And this payload type is about 7 bits. We have sequence number, which is 16 bits, time stamping, 32 bits, synchronization source, also known as S source, synchronization source, and then you have other field contributing source, another kind of information. Now the payload type also need to have this particular field is accompanied by other fields as well, such as version number, extensibility, other things. So payload type with others, basically put together 16 bits. Payload type is only 7 bits, which identified what kind of encoding scheme being used. For example, type 0 meaning PCM channel with 64 kbps. Type 3 meaning GCM, which is 13 kbps. Payload type 7 is linear predictive coding, which is basically give a difference between one byte to other, so minimal amount of data. And that would be given much lower bandwidth, 2.4 kbps. If you are doing the video frames, motion JPEG, so you indicate different kind of coding schemes. Then you have other 9 bits, which is version, padding, extension. So 9 bits plus this makes it 16 bits. Then you have a sequence number, which basically indicates ordering of the packets. And if you receive packet number 3 after packet number 2, And that basically means packet number two is lost. So when we receive packet number one, packet number three, time is stamping, and we don't receive packet number two, that means packet number two is lost. So sequencing is basically used for to enable detect, enable receiver to detect if there is a packet loss. And that application decides what is to be done with packet loss. RTBit only indicates there's a packet loss. And RTCP as a protocol periodically sends report to the sender. This is the current status of packet loss. This is the current status of delay, so that sender could decide an action if needs to be taken and can change the coding scheme midway. It does not mean that at the start, when you agree upon a coding scheme, it has to continue. If you see a congestion, see some packet loss, it can change the coding scheme to low bandwidth, or there's no packet loss, you can go back to good quality coding scheme. And that means each packet needs to have its own coding scheme. But this needs to be negotiated at the beginning, what coding scheme was supported by both the two entities which are communicating with each other. Then we have a timestamping field whose purpose is to basically identify what time packet should be played. So timestamping is the timestamp by the sender when this packet was generated. Now receiver, when receive it, we have seen it will add it some delay and determine what is to be played. But we need certainly timestamp to know when the packet was generated. By adding our own delay, we can determine the playout time. So role of timestamping is to determine the playout time. And let's say we are doing an audio conference or audio talk. Now, if there's a silence, we're not transmitting anything, but my time clock has to keep running. Because let's say I'm speaking for 1 second, then there's a silence for 1 second, then there I speak another one. So when I speak the second sentence, the timestamp is already 3rd second. And that should indicate, that means even though there is a silence, but source is inactive, there is no transmission happening. Because silence, you don't need to transmit. There's no point sending silence and saying, and then increasing the network load. So silence then gets transmitted. And because your time is stamping, receiver would know that if I'm getting a packet with a gap of time stamping, that basically means there's been silence there. And that is what we need timestamp for. And then synchronize and source ID. Again, 32 bits. Identify the source of RTP stream. Each stream, the multiple stream, has a distinct SSRC. For the same multimedia application, it's preferred to have same synchronization source, but they could be different. Same would make it easy to merge and mix the two streams, but does not mean it is mandatory, has to be the same. Now, it basically is identified by some random source number, and even initial timestamp with a random number, which is used to indicate, and there are a few other fields as well. You can look at more details of RTP. There's a good resource there. There are a good number of internet resources as well, some FAQs, and we can look at. So one question is, so you can look at basically more FAQ, the further FAQ.html, and you can find good number of questions related to RTP. RTP does not do real-time delivery, but we still call real-time protocol. Real-time delivery requirement is, it has to make sure that data is reached in real-time. If I'm transmitting something, my voice packet should reach within 150 milliseconds. RTP doesn't guarantee that I'm delivering a voice packet within 150 milliseconds. It provides an indication what time packet was generated so the receiver could know when the packet is received, can it be played out or not. So if receiver is ensuring that packet has to be played within 150 milliseconds, so look at the timestamp, look at the time which is being at the received, and delay is already more, simply discard. So RTP provides the information, but by itself does not ensure that packets are delivered within real time or the requirement. Does RTP provide any error recovery? RTP itself does not provide any recovery. The packets are lost, they are lost. However, it associated protocol RTCP does provide information to the sender, current status of delayed, current status of packet loss, and if sender want, it can change. But by itself, error recovery is left to the application. How does it want to recover? Should it use concealing? Should it use FEC, forward error corrector, or interleaving, or any other means? But RTP does not provide. Can RTP run over IPv6? Yes. RTP is using UDP, and UDP can run both on IPv4 and IPv6. So it does not really matter what the underlying IP layer is. It remains agnostic to that because it's making use of basically UDP. As you see, in typical every packet, we'd have a length field, but RTP does not have a length field. We already said when we're dealing with applications, application defines the chunk size. Like when I'm doing the RDO, we know that my RDO frame is 20 millisecond chunk. So I already know the length, and we add more fields by increasing the overhead, and that means increasing the processing time and causing more load. So we like to keep the minimal header. And since application know what the chunk size is, we really don't care about length field, and no length field is there in the RTP header. Further, timestamp, typically with each frame sent, we increase the timestamp by 1, or we are looking at, since my each RDO chunk constitute 20 milliseconds, and it consists of 160 bytes, so you might even increase by 160 from one value to the other, depending on how do we look at. Video frames, there are two standards. One is 25 frames per second, other 30 frames per second, and depending on the encoding scheme, the timestamp values increase by 300, 3000, or 3600 per frame, indicating how many bits are there. The timestamp values rated in multimedia conference, no. First value picked randomly, and all subsequent values are with offset to that, like in TCP sequence numbers, first sequence number is picked randomly, and everything is offset to that initial value, same happens to the timestamp case. We already discussed the role of timestamp and sequence number. The role of timestamp is to determine the play of time. The role of sequence number is to let receiver know if there is a packet loss and then take appropriate action by the application. And that is what the two different roles are. Sequence number always increases one packet. So for each packet, my sequence number would be unique, whereas timestamp, multiple packets may carry same timestamp, indicating all these packets have to be played around the same time. So multiple packets of a video frame can have same timestamp. Multiple streams can have same timestamp. So timestamp is different than the sequence number. When we do multimedia interaction, we don't use TCP for audio and video. Primary reason is TCP deals with congestion control, and if any packet loss occurs, it does a retransmission. And retransmission increases the delay significantly, which is very detrimental to multimedia audio. We are playing the real-time audio, and any delay would simply kill or degrade my applications. So because of retransmissions, the delay could be much larger. TCP is not used in RTP, and we use UDP because in UDP, there is no retransmission. So we already done this part. Let's look at the next question. So this is a question I look at last class, that we look at FEC, so understand, and this kind of questions you might even get. We had discussed two FEC schemes, forward encoding one, where for each N packet, we are sending N plus one packet, which is XOR of previous N packets. Second FEC scheme, we said, even with the main RDO coding, we also append low RDO encoding to the main channel, nominal channel. So consider the example where For every four packet, we send a fifth packet on FEC1. Basically meaning XOR all the four packets, and there's the fifth packet, which basically takes care if any packet is lost in four packet, we can regenerate. So FEC1 by N is four, so every four packet we're sending you, ending a fifth packet. In FEC2, my low encoding uses 25% of the original bandwidth of the main channel. So given this to FEC scheme, how much additional bandwidth each scheme requires? Let's say whatever my raw voice is, what is the extra bandwidth I need if I were to use FEC1? And what is the extra bandwidth I would need to use FEC2? Because if I would have extra bandwidth means if I were to transmit only these actual raw packets and nothing else, and now with FEC1, I'm sending extra information. So what is the extra bandwidth I need for FEC1 scheme and FEC2 scheme? Anyone? Let's look at some people. Shweta. Sri Vidya. Anyone?
So I don't know.
Given this, can't you make out? FEC1, what is the extra information we are sending? Every four packet, we are sending one extra packet. So what is the extra bandwidth we need? If you were to send only four packets, we need certain bandwidth. But FEC1, we are needing sending one extra packet. That means we need 25% extra bandwidth. Because you are sending one packet along with all the four packets. So extra packet, one for every four packets. So that means my bandwidth increases by 25%. In second case, already given that low encoding rate is at 25%, so we need 25% extra bandwidth. Is that clear? Any questions?
No, sir.
Given the two scheme, assuming that one packet out of every four packet is lost. Using these two schemes, assume that one packet out of every five packet is lost. Now, which coding scheme, FEC1 or FEC2, would give you better quality audio? Your two schemes, FEC1 and FEC2, assume that one out of every five packet is lost. Which one would give you better quality, audio quality, FEC1 or FEC2? Suja? Sudhakar? Shashank. Sindhu. Anyone, guys, give a thought. You have been given two schemes, FEC1, we sent one packet extra. FEC2, we are sending 25% payload with every packet extra. And we are saying one out of every five packet is lost. Which one would give you better audio quality? If you were to play the encoding with all packets with high encoding versus we were to play some packet with low rate encoding, which one would give you higher quality audio? Srividya? if I were to play all packets with high quality audio, or out of some packets, I were to play some with low quality audio, which one would user perceive as a better audio quality?
So low quality one, because it's continuous.
Repeat. Hello?
So low quality audio stream?
No. I'm saying quality perceptor. If I were to play all the high quality audio, user will get a better perception, better feeling. If I'm mixing some high quality audio with low quality packet, let's say I have transmitted 4 voice packets. And all the 4 I'm playing at the rate of 64 kbps. Versus I'm playing 3 packets with 64 kbps and 4 packets with 16 kbps. Which one would you get better feeling? All 4 with 64 kbps. Is that fine? Now, in the FEC1, if we lose 1 out of every 5 packets, we are generating back the lost packet, which was the high quality audio. So even though we lose 1 packet, we still get all the 4 packets with high quality audio. In the second case, once we lose a packet, for that packet, we'll play the low quality audio. And we ignore the other thing. So that means if you are using 1 out of every 5 packets, FEC1 would give me better audio quality perception than FEC2. Because in FEC1, I'm playing all the packets with high quality audio, even though 1 packet lost, because I could regenerate. In FEC2, the moment I lose a packet, for that particular packet, when I get next packet, I play the low quality audio. So FEC1 would give me better audio quality than FEC2 if I am losing 1 out of every 5. Now consider that I am losing every alternate packet. And every group of 2 packets, I am losing every alternate packet. Now which one would give me better audio quality, FEC1 or FEC2? I'm losing every alternate packet. Which one would give me better audio quality? If I'm losing every alternate packet, can I generate the original packet using FEC1? Yes, no, give somebody answer.
So maybe.
In FEC1, for every 4 packets, we are doing XORing and sending. So that means I can generate a packet only if 1 out of 5 packets is lost. If I'm losing more than 1 packet, I cannot regenerate. So if I'm losing every alternate packet, I cannot regenerate a lost packet using FEC1. So that means audio quality would be pathetically bad. Whereas in FEC2, every alternate packet is lost, but every packet which is received has the good encoding for the current and low encoding for the lost packet. So I'll basically be playing low encoding for 1 packet which is lost, high encoding for the received, low encoding for the next, high encoding for the next. So it will be little poor quality, but much better than FEC1, because I lost every alternate packet. There will be a lot of disturbance. So depending on how good your packet loss is, it determines what the audio quality is. If you are losing 1 out of every 5, FEC1 will give better audio quality because I can regenerate high quality packet. But if I am losing 1 out of every 3 or 1 out of every 4, then I cannot regenerate FEC1 lost packet. But in FEC2, I can still play the low quality audio, so it will give better results than FEC1. Other question is pertains to RTP. If you were to use a web server using streaming directly on TCP, can we really do that? Stored video we are streaming directly from your web server using TCP? Answer is yes, because when you use a web server uses HTTP, which makes use of TCP. Second is, when we are using RTP, is it possible to change the encoding scheme in the middle of a session? Answer is again yes, because RTCP does indicate the session quality, and if sender decides to change, it can probably change the encoding scheme. So answer in both cases is yes. So this brings to the end of our today's lecture. And next, we will next lecture on Monday, we'll discuss SIP, session initiation protocol, and that will complete our the module 4. And then Tuesday onwards, we'll move to the module 4, which is security. Any questions, please feel free to ask. Otherwise, we can basically discuss. If no questions, you can disconnect and join next session at next class whenever you have. Thank you.